If Zimbabwe is truly open for business, then the next 100 days should usher in free, diverse, and independent media. March 4, 2018 marked President Mnangagwa's first 100 days in office. This American concept of grading a president's 100 days was born of the Great Depression when Franklin D. Roosevelt was in the Oval Office. In America today, Donald Trump has spent 100 days in office at one of his golf clubs. Zimbabwe is open for business is the new theme of the new dispensation. How many times have we heard this?
That Zimbabwe is open for business.
Zimbabwe is open for business.
Open for business. But Zimbabwe is open for business.
A lot. But what does it really mean? Not much if you look at the numbers. Zimbabwe is ranked 159 out of 190 economies on the World Bank Ease Doing Business scale. Try setting up a business. It takes 60 days to register one. Next door in Zambia, just 9 days. A couple of days in Rwanda. If you're a foreign investor, you need to go out, fill out a form at the Zimbabwe Investment Authority. That form costs $500. When you get approval, you must pay $2,500 for an investment license. And did you know, there are 35 acts of parliament related just to mining in Zimbabwe. And all of these laws are run by over 15 different ministries. Imagine all the offices you need to go to, or the corruption you have to deal with, or the paperwork, the admin. During the first 100 days, the president has done well to amend the indigenization law, a law which required Zimbabweans to hold a majority stake in any business. All farmers are going to be offered 99-year leases, which will safeguard their tenure on the land. And we're no longer just looking east, no. Zimbabwe has expanded its horizons, mending relationships and re-engaging the broader international community. If Zimbabwe is truly open for business, then the next 100 days should usher in free, diverse, and independent media. See the alignment of laws to the new constitution and provide a clear roadmap to free, fair, and credible elections. Unless backed by real reforms, Zimbabwe is open for business is just a slogan wrapped in a colorful scarf. On the other side of the Limpopo, South Africa's parliament passed a motion by 241 votes to 83 mandating an investigation into a possible constitutional amendment to allow the government to take back land from the majority white landowners without compensation.
Now, the National Assembly, meanwhile, has passed a motion on land expropriation without compensation tabled by the EFF.
The legal process to expropriate has now been put in motion. 241 members voted for the motion, while 83 voted against it. It will now be referred to Parliament's Constitutional Review Committee to process the amendments and also review Section 25 of the Constitution, which deals with the expropriation of land.
We must ensure that we restore the dignity of our people without compensating the criminals who stole our land.
The ANC, the National Freedom Party, the EFF, and the IFP are all in agreement we must expropriate. So what is the delay? There's no need for a debate. Let's go forward. Let's go out there and expropriate.
We in Zimbabwe have been there. At the time of the execution of land reform in Zim, white people made up less than 5% of the population of Zimbabwe, yet they owned more than 55% of the most agriculturally productive or arable land in the country. 11 million hectares of the richest land were still in the hands of under 5,000 commercial farmers, the great majority of them white. Land which they had inherited from a colonial past built on discriminatory racial hierarchy. In Zimbabwe, the Lancaster House Agreement addressed the issue of land at independence and had specific provisions for land redistribution, which the British were supposed to pay for. And as we all know by now, the British reneged on this side of the agreement, and the willing buyer, willing seller stance did not work. When in 1992 ZANU-PF tabled yet another bill to address the land issue, white farmers reacted with sheer arrogance, just like we're seeing in SA today. They told themselves it would never happen. Mugabe wouldn't dare. Well, Mugabe dared, and it got ugly. Who can forget Konrad Chinotimba and his straw hats telling white farmers to go back to London? Now, of course, the fundamentals of what happened in Zimbabwe and what is happening in South Africa today are a lot more loaded and require a lot more time to unpack all the nuances. What I will labor on for now, though, is the fact that white South Africans and the Western media like shouting the word Zimbabwe every time blacks in South Africa demand land or challenge white privilege. It's meant to scare blacks into silence. But shouting Zimbabwe at historical imbalances won't make them go away. According to a 2017 census, white people make up less than 8% of South Africa's entire population. In a country with 56 million people, less than 5 million of them are white. Yet 24 years after the end of apartheid, almost 60% of South Africa's land today is owned by people who happen to be white. The prime productive arable land, the gold mines, the platinum mines, diamond mines, you name it, are all owned primarily by white people. Not to diminish their evident hard work and ability, but their wealth and status is not a coincidence. They inherited much of this from colonialism and apartheid days when white South Africans owned over 80% of the land and had a monopoly on every other facet of the economy. It's a fact that white people in South Africa still remain the economically dominant minority due to colonialism and subsequently apartheid. These are the facts. It is grossly unjust and the injustice must be addressed and rectified. But some words of caution to both sides in South Africa. As your Zimbabwean buddies, there's a lot that you can learn from our recent history and hopefully avoid some of the mistakes and pains that we went through. To the government, nobody can argue that the land and wealth redistribution is long overdue, but the execution will determine whether anyone wins or if both sides lose. Redistributing and increasing access to land for black people without addressing fundamental issues like industry skills and knowledge gap for the communal workers, lack of infrastructure, and the obvious market access barriers will take South Africa down the Zimbabwe-style economic downward spiral that a lot of scaremongers are currently touting. A stronger word of caution to the white people in South Africa that's been up in arms over this recent amendment. In the words of Peter Steyl, president of the Commercial Farmers Union in Zimbabwe, who said this in 2017 speaking to Reuters, "We were arrogant. We thought they would never take the land because we were too important for the economy." His message to white farmers in SA today, "It's better to give a little bit now than to lose everything." Look, when you have stubborn, entitled, wealthy white minorities on one side and a government making populist moves on the other, history across the continent shows that the revolution will always win. The wealth disparities in South Africa hit you just in the face. Riding from the train from the airport in Johannesburg or driving from the airport in Cape Town, you can't help but notice the juxtaposition of the dirt-poor townships and places like the richest square mile in Africa, Sandton. The injustices are not sustainable. Confronting the issue head-on is long overdue, but it all comes down to execution, execution, execution. Otherwise, South Africa, prepare to see the comrades at your gates.